Yeah, so I've had quite a few confirmations this morning of what I'm sharing with you. I think we should have worshipped afterwards. Yeah. We also have two other birthdays, by the way, coming up this week. On the 8th, it is Aniki Oka, and on the 9th, it is Janet Blackburn. Okay. Right. I want us to look at two scriptures this morning, and the first one is 1 Peter 2. Verse 20 and 21. If you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. I think the one thing that we can be so 100% sure of is that we never ever have to doubt the love that Jesus has for us. And that he sees the full picture. He sees things that we cannot see. He sees the beginning, but he also sees the end. And we must remember that. And we need to remember that things don't precisely happen the way that we want it. But God in the end will reveal his glory still in our lives. So the next time that you struggle to understand the actions of God, just know one thing that you need and I need to just keep our eyes on him and keep trusting him. Okay. And yeah, then we are definitely going to get the ones that is going to respond and say, yes, but my struggles are my cross that I need to bear. Matthew 16:24. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone of you would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. And now what did Jesus mean with that cross that we need to take up? And I think what we need to look at is, we need to look at what it doesn't mean. Because sometimes people think that a burden to carry is like a strained relationship, or a job that's not working out, or a physical illness, that is the cross that they need to take up and live with. It's difficulties. It's not necessarily the cross that we need to take up. In Jesus' day, remember, the cross meant one thing, death, crucifixion. To carry a cross was to face the most painful humiliation ever. But today, as Christians, we view the cross as a symbol of love, grace, forgiveness. And to take up your cross and follow Jesus means to be willing to die to yourself fully. 100%, die and surrender to him. That is what the cross is. Let's carry on and read verse 25 and 26. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it. What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world, yet forfeits his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? We might think that to take up the cross is tough, but oh boy, the reward is matchless. Matchless. Nothing in the world is worth giving up eternity with God. I want to read Luke 9, verse 57 to 62. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lie his head. He said to another man, Follow me. But the man replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, Let the dead bury themselves, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. And still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus replied, No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the service of the kingdom of God. Three people were willing to follow Jesus. But when he pressed them, the commitment showed to be half-hearted. They were not really going to follow him. They failed to count the cost of following Jesus. None of them were willing to pick up that cross and follow him. John 4:23, yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. What kind of a worshipper are we? Are we really seeking to take up our cross and following Jesus? And there's a few questions that I want to ask you. Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means that you are going to lose your closest friends? Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means that you're going to be separated from your family? Are you willing to follow Jesus and lose your reputation? Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means that you're going to lose your income or your job? Are you willing to follow him if it means you have to lose your life? Following Jesus doesn't mean that all or some of these things might happen to you. But we need to realize that as disciples of Christ, we must be willing to suffer loss. Are you willing? Am I willing to take up that cross? We are faced with a choice. What choice are we going to make this morning? And remember that what we are going to choose is going to determine eternal life or eternal death. We need to take up our cross daily. Only when we take up that cross, we can be called his disciples. Jesus will never ask you to do something that he did not do himself. I said this before. He bore the cross. He led the way. He took the cross out of obedience. Obedience to his Father. And he did it humbly. He put God's will and his love for his people, that is you and me, above himself. And he died for you and for me. And that is the example that you and I need to follow. Perfect example. Be obedient and humbly consider others before yourself. Just to get to back to obedience, Marnus and Carly was sharing with us this morning in the kitchen. They've decided to do something, try something. And in the chaos of getting ready in the mornings for school, for work, Marnus decided, okay, he's going to take up his Bible, his notebook, and in the midst of that chaos, the morning chaos, he's going to sit and he's going to have quiet time. Because he thought that the Lord said, get back to obedience. Let's see how long it takes the kids and everyone to see what he's doing and join in. And you won't believe, he said, he called it the challenge of the Father's heart. And I thought it was so nice. And he said on day two, Liam said to him, Papa, what maak jy? And he said, I'm having quiet time. And he said, maar ek wil saam met jou stilte tyd hou. He said, and so the next day, Amke joined. And he says, now it is, everybody wants to do something, read something, pray something. And he's so into worship. But I must say, he's for a little boy of 7, very much into the Holy Spirit. And then he's at a stage where he says to Marnus, they're doing the worship at Shofar, what are we singing? We must sing this, then we do this. And Marnus said to him, yeah, I can only eintlik saam met ons die worship doen nie. And I say, hoekom nie? So he's actually off guitar and all. He's going to help them with the worship this morning. But that challenge of the Father's heart. Fathers, do you know what a responsibility you have towards your children? To get them back to the Father's heart. Back into quiet time. Back into worshiping Him and Him alone. Discipleship is self-denial, cross-bearing, obedience, full stop. Obedience. I listened to an amazing testimony this week by a guy named John Mulindi. I've never heard of him. But he stood up in front of a congregation of thousands of people. And this guy was so soft-spoken, and he said, you know what? This morning, I'm standing in front of you. He says, and I need to share with you what the Lord revealed to me. He's a pastor now, remember? Pastor of a church of thousands. And he said, the first thing the Lord said to him was, you have to deal with sin in your life. And he thought, I'm a pastor. I don't have sin in my life. And the Lord said to him, you know, John, when you look at a woman, you undress that woman. That's what you see. And he thought, true. So he dealt with that. And he thought, that's done. And the Lord said to him, no, I'm not done. And the Lord showed him something else. And he thought, okay, that's done. And the Lord said, no, I'm not done. And he showed him something else. And I'm saying something else, but he mentioned it. He mentioned it to these people in this congregation, and he went through the whole list. And eventually he said to the Lord, you know what, Lord? But I prayed for the sick, and they got healed. I drove out demons. And the Lord said to him, you know what, John? That was me. And that guy was so humble. And there he's standing in front of this congregation. En hy bely net die een sonde na die ander een en die ander een. En die Here maak hom vry. free. Free. And that is you and me. Are we free? What sins are holding us back? The scripture that I've got next is, strangely enough, the scripture that was used as well yesterday at Awaken. Matthew 7:21. He warns us in Matthew 7:21 that not everyone who calls me Lord, Lord will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do what my Father in heaven wants them to do. And in verse 22, we receive a clear warning. When the judgment day comes, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, in your name we spoke, God's message, but by your name we drove out many demons and performed miracles. And in verse 23, then I will say to them, I never knew you. Get away from me, you wicked people. May that never happen to us. The call to take up your cross and follow Christ is an invitation to die to yourself and your own desires, your own sins. And if I have to summarize what I've just said, I'll do it like this. To take up my cross means to surrender my will and plans to God, and to allow him to transform me into the person that he created me to be. It means that I have to prioritize the kingdom of God above anything else. It involves standing firm in my faith, even when it means that I will be unpopular. It means loving others and meeting the needs of others before my own. It means living a life that imitates Christ. It means desiring, laying down my desires, all of it. It means to prioritize the kingdom of God first. And it means that I have to be unwavering in my commitment to him. It means that we will suffer persecution for the sake of his name. And it means that we will be known by the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. 2 weeks ago in cell, we were discussing something similar. Because there are really Christians in other countries that are really persecuted for their faith. We don't know this. We hear of it. And Rudy asked the question and he said, what about you? What about you as a Christian, if you are to be persecuted, what will you do? What will I do? If all of a sudden had to flee, leave your family behind, what will you do? Here the guys came up with quite innovative responses. But to be honest, when we left cell that night, we got home, and a fear all of a sudden gripped my heart. And I thought, you know, we say this, we say we're following him, we're picking up our cross, we're bearing our cross, but what if we are to be persecuted? What are we going to do? We as adults can take care of ourselves. Our kids, most of them are adults. What about our children? Children's children, grandchildren. What about the little ones? I'm going nowhere without my grandchildren, just so you know. If I have to flee, I'm taking them with me. And now the part that Ian stole this morning. Who of you are sitting here this morning and you are in fear because of this? Or anything else? What fear do you have in your life that you need to lie down. No one with any fear. You're great. I pray that God will remove that fear. And when he removes it, he will fill that void with love and joy. And that he will give you that peace. Christians must learn to recognize the value of persecution and rejoice in it. Because in James 1 verse 2 to 4 we read, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." Hosanna Wong wrote this, "Keep being faithful without an applause. Keep being faithful without everyone being for you. Keep being faithful without everyone understanding what you are called to do. Keep faithful without knowing how God is going to make a way. Keep being faithful without knowing what the results will be on the other side of your yes." He calls us, you and me, to be faithful. Oh, I just felt in my heart this morning, are you sure? 100% sure that you know that you know that you know that when you walk out this door, a car hits you and you die, that you'll be fine. There's one absolutely. Everyone with fear and trembling needs to sort out their salvation now. Make sure that your life is sorted out and right with God. We don't know the hour, we don't know the time when he decides to fetch us. Make right with him before it is too late. Let us take part in communion this morning, and when we do, let's recommit ourselves to him and thank him for what he has endured on the cross for you and for me. He took up a heavy cross and he carried it on your and my behalf. Let's just surrender to him. Surrender all and then take part this morning in communion.
All the saints and angels, they bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You worthy of it all. All things, and to you are all things.
finished the race. I've kept the faith. Now there's in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face to you and give you peace. Amen. Let's take the tithes and offerings this morning. And while we're taking up the tithes and offerings, I would really like to encourage you to, if you do not belong to a cell group, or your cell group, you stopped going with COVID. COVID's no excuse anymore, eh? Join a cell group. Start a cell group. Okay?
Power, our God, our God.
floor. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in,
my heart will choose to say, Lord bless.